So, blockchains, cryptocurrencies, and security. And what I'm going to do is to cover some of the basics of why blockchain came about, how it's been developed, and some of the consequences that are becoming apparent now. And I'll be actually putting this video up onto my own YouTube, university YouTube channel, for people outside the university to have a look at them as well, because they're getting interested in some of the things I'm doing. So the next 45, 50 minutes, I'm going to cover these three objectives. Why blockchain? A little bit of a history of the blockchain. Show you actually what the blockchain concept really is, and then lead on to some of the more fascinating and potentially extremely worrying consequences. Well, what it is, and this is the formal definition, it may not actually mean very much as written like that, a distributed, secure, non-repudiatable, immutable record of transactions between two parties. The term blockchain is related to the implementation technology. The real terminology is distributed ledger technology. And I'll show you later on why that term is more important. And it also leads to some of the consequences and limitations of what blockchains can or cannot do, or should not do for that matter as well. And fundamentally, its purpose is to provide trust between the two parties in terms of the transactions they're undertaking, even between people who do not trust each other. So if you think about Bitcoin, why should you trust me? Why should I trust you? But at least the theory is, if it goes through this system and it says, I've transferred $50 worth of Bitcoins to you, that is a permanent record that everybody knows that you've now got my $50 worth of Bitcoins, and you can then use it for somebody else. So it's intended to provide trust. Now, in networks, you may or may not already have come across the Byzantine general's problem. For example, you're thinking about polling between multiple servers, multiple switches. How do you know which one to trust? Can you trust them all? Do you have to check multiple sources, multiple messages to compare and contrast them? The original Byzantine general problem is you got somewhere here, the general, with various kernels spread around the countryside, and they've got to try and actually coordinate the attack. And they can only communicate by untrusted mechanisms. And in the original problem is people on foot or on horseback going from there to there to there to there, and maybe to there. That was supposed to be a trusted lieutenant or colonel, but turns out to have been switch sides. So how do these three guys know that they've got the right message? That someone here hasn't actually caught them, given them the opposite message, and sent them to there, to there, to there? And it turns out, mathematically, that if you've got something like two-thirds, or can see two-thirds of the messages are all the same, you can probably trust that one. And the reason for this is part of this distributed ledger approach, where you've got lots and lots of people involved, and you're trying to ensure that the messages that build into the ledger are the correct ones. They haven't been misused or changed. For example, one of the problems with cryptocurrencies is you could be spending your money, the same bitcoins, twice. So you send some back to me and some over there. How do we know which of those two transactions is the correct one? Because we can't spend money twice. Although we can try to do it, especially over the untrusted internet, because we don't trust each other. And so they've come up with some mathematics which kind of help to ensure that we can trust the messages that are stored inside this blockchain, whether it's Bitcoin or any of the other thousands of different implementations. Now, there's something like 1,400 different cryptocurrencies, lots of other token currency things, and a whole lot of important, more industrial-grade, supposedly, products coming out for business-to-business use. And they still have the problem of having, they need an immutable record. So what is the distributed ledger? Well, if you look at blockchain, everybody talks about Alice and Bob wanting to communicate with each other and transfer money from Alice to Bob. And the idea of the distributed ledger technology is you don't have a single trusted ledger. Our bank account is a ledger, in essence. Or at least there's a ledger in the bank that we all trust. We all trust the ledgers in Visa, MasterCard. So you might ask, why do we want blockchain? Well, I'll come on to one of the reasons later on, but the point here is, if you have a single environment like a bank, in principle, that can go down. And we've seen them go down regularly over the last few years. And then everything kind of grinds to a halt. Now the point here is, you've now got multiple spread around the world. And they all duplicate each other, subject to a bit of latency. And this is where you guys come into designing your networks to reduce the latencies, at least down to the fundamental physics limits. So there are, in Bitcoin, nobody's quite sure how many copies of the ledger there are, but it's thought to be of the 100 to 150,000 copies of the Bitcoin ledger spread around the world. So, you know, it's kind of always going to be up and running. Slightly fingers crossed. And one of the things about that is you can't adjust that one without it being found later on by all the others. There are some interesting aspects to that question as well, by the way, that blockchains work. So the idea is Alice and Bob don't really trust each other. They don't trust any other intermediaries. They just want to get money between each other, kind of at the speed of light. Well, call it 20 minutes with Bitcoin. It takes 20 minutes for your transaction. If you're very, very lucky to get authorized, it could be hours and hours. I mean, I was watching the Bitcoin backlog a month or two back, and there were 110,000 transactions, which could be processed at 2,000 transactions every 10 minutes. So go calculate, quite a lot. But it doesn't always run like that. It's more typically 10, 15, 20,000 in the queue. So it takes a little while, it doesn't happen quite at the speed of light. But you've got this environment where everybody knows or can trust who's got what, most of the time. So why? What is ultimately what's going on? Well, first of all, digitalization of assets. Not pieces of paper. You know, £5 notes, £10 notes, they're bits of paper. And they can get lost, they can get burnt and stolen and so on. Now, if I can have it electronically, the theory goes, on the distributed, lots and lots of servers, it's very difficult to lose track of my £5 note sort of thing, or equivalent. That's a theory. It can also be used for identifying who owns what. And there are projects running at the moment for ownership of houses, particularly in countries where they don't have a good land registry, such as we have had in this country for many, many decades. So if they can't put that together, and in any case nobody trusts bureaucracy, the government bureaucracy, because it's all riddled with graft and bribery and so on, well, is there a way that we can actually do it electronically? That's the theory. Or digital rights management for music, photos. At the moment it's a little bit tricky. We're all terribly keen to download our music and our photos for free without paying anything, even though theoretically we should do. And most digital rights management systems don't work very well. Pop stars, pop groups, who get paid badly by organisations like Instagram or whoever, all the various organisations that provide your music for you, they take a lot of money off you, and you don't get much of the money that you feel you should do. So maybe there's something here that makes it possible for me to upload a piece of music, claim ownership, and then using some sort of micropayments, get payments directly from you before you can play it. because of that distribution of all the copies of the blockchain around the world, theoretically, we can provide this decentralized security assurance. They're using cryptography, fairly good high-level cryptography, to try and make sure that that ownership can't be claimed by other people very easily. The transaction happens kind of wherever. In fact, a copy of your transaction goes out to every single one of those distributed ledgers around the world, those 150 or 1,000 Bitcoin ones, and they've all got one copy, signed, digitally signed by you, going to somebody else's recipient. The idea then is we can move money around the world effectively and anonymously, which leads to all sorts of misuses of Bitcoin, as we've seen. Mostly, well, the 2,000 transactions happening per every 10 minutes or 20 minutes. You know, most of them are on the black web, dark web. Money laundering as well. And of late, it became, because of the boom in the value of the Bitcoins, up to $19,000 per Bitcoin for a very short time, people have got into it for investment purposes, until they find it's rather difficult to get the money back out of the blockchain because most of the banks are now no longer playing with or cooperating. And as of last week, the UK Financial Conduct Authority is now saying all cryptocurrency activity is and will be regulated by the FCA. The Americans are doing that, and other countries around the world are saying, right, it's no longer the Wild West. It's now formally going to be properly regulated. That's going to make interesting. And then, of course, you've got the misuse of this word called smart, the smart economy, whatever that might mean. It allows things to happen in different ways. But is it actually, the fundamental question of all of this is, what is it adding to what we already have? Is it any different in any significant way? Now, the other thing, when blockchain was very first created, it was actually nothing to do with the technology. Primarily, it was a political movement. What the people did, who invented it didn't like was, here's us trying to pay each other, and we've got all of these middlemen in the middle taking their big cuts. Particularly if you don't pay off your credit card quickly enough, you know, you've got interest rates like that. The Visa takes something like 2-3% of the transaction, whereas Bitcoin now only takes 2%, and depends how much you want to pay as a result, partly for your transfer from Bitcoin to Sterling or Sterling to Bitcoin, and also how much you have to pay to Bitcoin blockchain to get your transaction processed in any reasonable amount of time. Theoretically, you can do it for zero cost, but don't bet on your transaction happening in any reasonable amount of time if the queue's big. If you want it done quickly, you've got to pay $2 equivalent, and then it'll jump to the top of the queue, or near the top of the queue. But you then have to think about, well, if I'm wanting to pay someone I don't know and I don't trust, like, you know, you buy something, I don't know, off eBay, someone in another country, or even someone in this country. At least with eBay, most of the time, if the goods don't turn up, you get your money back. It's nice to have an intermediary. If you have a Visa credit card transaction, as long as it's not too big, the transaction, if the stuff doesn't turn up, you get your money back. If you do it with Bitcoin, there's no intermediary to handle those sort of things. With your credit card, if you lose your PIN or your credit card gets stolen, you just phone them up, they send a new credit card, new number, and possibly a new PIN. If you lose your digital identity on blockchain, on Bitcoin, oh, you will never get those Bitcoins back. You can't reset your ID or your password. It's a one-time code creation of your private key, typically 64 hex digits, and the derivable public key. tea, which is shared with all and sundry. You can't recreate that and regain your access to your assets, which is another interesting thing that no one yet, that I've been seeing in the discussions, has actually started thinking about. More of that anon. So this disintermediation is a political exercise which may actually not have a very good result in practice. If you're owning, if you're buying, and have any of you ever bought or sold a house? Most of you have rented a house, have you, or rented a flat or something. Did you ever get a lawyer involved, or did you just sign on the dotted line without even looking at the words? Yeah, like we do with everything. If you're buying a house, you kind of want to know, does that person really have title to the house? What are the other aspects that come with owning that house? Is it a graded list 2, which means you can't do this, this, and this, or if it's list 1 graded, that's even worse. Makes it difficult to buy or to sell those because people really don't want to have all those extra obligations. Or did you know that if you bought my house in the middle of Derby, there's a covenant that says I won't have a chicken shed, I think it is, on the ground. Not that I actually want one, but hey. But finding all those things, I wouldn't want to buy a house over using a blockchain without any lawyers, solicitors, etc., using some of the clever stuff called smart contracts that can come out of this. Why? Why do I want to get rid of these intermediaries who do useful things? And trust the blockchain people, who are hackers essentially. They are open source code writers who are not very clever. They don't write enterprise grade software. And we're now trusting them. So we're trusting different intermediaries. It's like Uber. Uber, when it first came out, was not a taxi company, which it is now, but it was a platform. They provided a connection mechanism between you and a driver. So, hey, we can go cheaper than a taxi because, well, we actually got rather large overheads, but don't tell anybody that. We will still charge you less than a black cab or a yellow cab. But they become the new intermediaries. Airbnb is a new intermediary for renting rooms. And they take much more money than the old intermediaries did, as it turns out, because their platforms are so staggeringly expensive to set up. And the funny thing is, now that you are in London and a few other cities in the UK, they were setting the prices 30% below the prices that black cabs and so on used to set, Addison Lee in London. Now Addison Lee are charging pretty much the same prices as Uber, and Addison Lee are making a profit, and Uber is still burning through money like there's no tomorrow, even with their 30% subsidised taxi fares, which they subsidise with the intention of forcing everybody else out of business so they could then raise the price back to some economic level that would allow them to make a profit. But it turns out they can't make a profit, whereas Addison Lee and the black cabs are making profits at similar sort of price levels. Fascinating idea. So you're not getting rid of your intermediaries, you're just switching them for people who are infinitely more avaricious and far less responsible by and large. So we can see Bitcoin started with this guy called Satoshi Nakamoto. We don't know who that person is, whether it's one person or a group of people, but this guy was the one who had this political objective of disintermediation with this trusted technology that you can have trust with an untrusted environment. May 2010, the first Bitcoins turned up, and they were very, very cheap indeed at that stage. Originally, 10,000 Bitcoins equaled $25. Now worth about 6 million. That was only a month or two ago, when it was closer to $10,000 or $20,000 in early January. Various other people started jumping on the bandwagon. Have you heard of Ethereum, anybody? Yeah, that started in July 2014. And
that's a little bit more interesting than Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is really just transferring money around the world.
Ethereum does something cleverer, and I'll explain how it works in a bit. But essentially, the digital payload, which in here is just a money number, the digital payload in here can be some money, it's Ether, or it can be something called a smart contract, which is a piece of programming that does stuff. Here was one of the very first industrial grade ones, the R3 Corda. There's an industrial grade project for banks to communicate with each other. Another bank one, so there are quite a few consortia of banks working with different organizations to develop different types of applications, different ways of doing blockchain, mainly for money transfers between financial institutions. As you can see, the number of these startups is rapidly rising, and there are a lot of projects going on today about using blockchains or experimenting with blockchains for all sorts of things. There's one in the third world, handling the supply chain between the third world for things like organic cotton, to try and monitor what's happening in the supply chain as stuff gets harvested, baled, and then moved through to where it's spun and woven and so on. And everybody is jumping on the bandwagon. Everybody, but everybody is actually doing it. And they're spending a staggering amounts of money. How does it work? What are the basically three fundamentals in the technology? The first one is cryptography. You know about hashes, do you? Come across MD5 hash and SHA-256 and so on. That's one of the fundamentals of how the thing works. Plus, also things like RSA and elliptic curve cryptography for the digital IDs and so on. One of the ways that's important, particularly for the public untrusted blockchains like the cryptocurrencies, is something called proof of work, which is something that's very hard to do, but very, very easy to check. So that it makes it very difficult to change the information on the blockchain, even just with one copy. When you've got the peer-to-peer with this distributed sets of all of the whole ledger around everybody involved, where everybody is trying the proof of work to be the first to actually solve that conundrum and therefore get paid for it, this is a fundamental aspect of the public untrusted ones. You've got to use proof of work. If you go inside trusted environments, bank to bank, where you trust everybody, pretty much, they can use all sorts of different ways, which are much, much less resource consumptive. This is very, very resource consumptive. Basically, the whole blockchain software does stuff. It guarantees the continuity of data. In other words, when I first get part of a Bitcoin, half of it, say, then where does my half go? And where does the other half go? And if I split it up to pay for $2 worth, which is kind of tiny, tiny, tiny bit of a Bitcoin, then it splits up into large numbers. And when I want to, if I've got lots of little bits, and I want to pay for something that's big, then I have to sort of have a list on the left-hand side of lots of my little Bitcoin ownership that add up to the amount that I'm going to pay to you. And this provides that continuity. All the nodes, these are what they call the mining nodes or the validator nodes, where they do this proof of work that guarantees the integrity of the whole blockchain. This is where latency happens. There's lots of latency in the system. Bitcoin, let's say, this sort of 10 minute or 20 minute cycle collecting up those 6 transactions a second or whatever through the 2,000 that fit into a block and then process it. And then each of the transactions are moving money around or to stop it, various things that happen. There are basically scripts which are attached to the individual transactions to make things happen correctly on the servers. Guarantees and attempts to prevent duplicates, it does by and large. Falsification is extraordinarily difficult because then they're replicated across all 100,000 nodes or whatever or more. Not sure it reduces server costs because the amount of money that people are spending on the application-specific ICs and the GPUs that they're using means that the Bitcoin, actually, I'm not sure why anybody said that one, because it ain't true. It's staggeringly expensive. I mean, if you want the top-end NVIDIA GPUs at the moment, you can't buy them for love and money. They've gone up to $4,000 or $5,000 a throw, because they're all going over to China for the Bitcoin mining farms. Zero downtime because there's 100,000 of them out there. If one link goes down to one node, tough, it'll get synchronized a bit later on, but most of the others will be there. No central authority, that's not entirely true. The Bitcoin development of community, load of open source programmers, actually are the central authority. They like to think that they're not a central authority. It's not a government authority, but it's a programmers. And they have debates every now and then about what they need to do. And one of the big debates they're going to have in the fairly near future is what to do about the encryption algorithms, just like all the banks are doing that at the moment, I suspect. Because banks use RSA. And I'm not sure whether Bitcoin uses RSA or whether it uses elliptic curves or whatever, but almost all encryption algorithms are susceptible to quantum computing. And within the next 5-10 years maybe, all or almost all encryption algorithms are going to fall. And that means everything that had been encrypted up to now, or when they fire those up, now become completely transparent. There is one, and I forget what its name is, one encryption algorithm at the moment which is resistant to quantum computing. Whether and when and how the Bitcoin open source community will debate and agree and implement a quantum computing resistant algorithm is going to be very, very interesting to see how that happens. Although the Bitcoin blockchain itself has not been hacked as far as anyone knows directly, we know that the peripheral parts of the technology are very susceptible. Mt. Gox, you've heard of, I guess. That was a Bitcoin exchange that does the exchanging between Bitcoins and other currencies and other cryptocurrencies. Went down in 2014, I think it is. And had been hacked big time. So these are the wallets and the exchanges where people store their IDs and their accounts rather than necessarily on their mobile phones or their PCs or whatever. And that's where at the moment most of the thefts have come from, by nicking people the whole of a set of somewhat insecure digital IDs held on some server outside of the blockchain. And this leads actually to one of the interesting points about blockchain. It is immutable inside itself and pretty much trusted. But everything that happens outside and feeds across the boundaries of those transactions is in principle untrustable. Because humans are very good at spoofing stuff. They're very good at fraud. And that's where we see a lot of things happening around other applications that are being thought about at the moment. Now, the point about what blockchain does or distributed ledger technology is you have, think about an ordinary database. You've got write, read, amend, delete, haven't you? Bog standard relational database technology. In fact, any database has those four functions. DLT is write once, read many. There is no delete. There is no amend. Therein lies some very interesting conundrums, which we'll see about shortly. a verifiable digital identity which is anonymous. You've just got this 32 or 64 character hex code, which is your public key, your identity, whatever. It's anonymous. However, it's actually feasible, and people have done it now, with enough work from the intelligence services and the police, crime detection, they can, in particular instances, actually work back and do some very, very clever detective work to identify some of the things that have gone wrong. They managed to work out what happened with the Mt. Gox, where they lost millions upon millions of dollars worth of bitcoins. Yeah, without any digital signatures, verifiable identity, sort of. You don't know who it is, but you know that's a valid identity. Access globally, peer-to-peer. Blockchain can do things like land title, and that could be very important for third world countries. Because one of the problems in third world countries is that there is no central register of land. You can't, even if you've got a house, a proper brick house with some value to it, it's very difficult to actually register your ownership of that. Therefore you can't get mortgages, therefore you can't get loans for your business and so on. If you've got something like that, it could be quite important, quite valuable for helping the economy to grow. With what they're doing in diamond trading to get out of the blood diamonds, they're now individually engraving every single diamond, however small. And so that if they can get those signatures into a blockchain of some sort, then that could become a rather valuable way of tracing this and proving this is not a blood diamond. If you remember a few years ago, I forget which top pop star, well, it's all top 10 in the world, was accused of having got some blood diamonds from I forget which country as a gift, $50 million worth, I think, of big diamonds. And she couldn't prove whether or not they were blood diamonds or not, but this would do. But there are ways of doing that. You can, using Ethereum-like smart contracts, enforce contracts. They have to be fairly trivial because, as someone said just recently, the complexity of a smart contract in Ethereum is no more smart than a smart game in a 1999 smartphone, which then you think, but 1999, the cleverest phone was probably a Nokia, and the thing that it had on that, the game, was snakes. So it's not terribly smart. It's essentially a series of if-then-else clauses. That's all you can build, really, in smart concepts. Why businesses would ever want to use this for ledgering, I have no idea, because they've already got ledgers for everything that they need. They've got their accounting system, they've got their inventory management system, which are ledgers plus their consolidated stock condition values and so on. I have no understanding why any company would want to use something like blockchain internally. It doesn't do anything for them. What you can see here, this is by SAP, and as you will recall, you've probably seen, every time you get a new technology, all the big companies jump on board and become evangelical. It's a new religion almost. They don't want smart, critical thinking. They don't want people to think, is it really going to solve anything? Does it add anything to what we already have? Because we've got encryption, already we've got VPNs to communicate between people pretty securely. If you're in the financial services world, banks, they don't go use VPNs, they have point-to-point cabling. Yeah, it's impossible to break into it. It goes from your server switch to my server switch. Not over the internet with VPNs. This is serious high grading, and then they will use high grade encryption over that link as well. Just the double baggies, you might say. So SAP here are being kind of a bit evangelical without wanting you to start thinking about why on earth would I do that? If I'm using SAP software, it does everything I need in a very secure way within my business. And all that blockchain would do, if you're an international company, it would provide that messaging system between all your parties. But I've got a messaging system already, which is secure. something like that, which then feeds into my full SAP environment. So I still have SAP. I'm not going to calculate how many bits I've got in that box from my ledger, which has the movements in and out, because that's going to take forever to calculate. I just want to go stop condition X, box Y, 55. I can send out 47 quite happily. And do that in milliseconds, microseconds. After the blockchain DLT, rubbish. Now, have you ever seen the Gartner hype curves, anybody? If you haven't, go look for them, they're fascinating. This is the latest one from Emerging Technology, it comes from Gartner, and what it does is show five stages of how things happen. Innovation. People have bright ideas and then go looking for money to develop it. Some of them will happen, some of them won't. Go up to, this is not just the best thing since sliced bread, this is far better than sliced bread ever was at the top there. People are pouring money in as it goes up there. Then it comes, that's earth peak inflated expectations, and that's where blockchain is at the moment. Huge, huge inflation expectation. It can do everything you ever wanted and lots better. Because I want our money to go develop on it. Then it comes down here, and oh dear, the slough of despond, it's kind of not worked out. Surprise, surprise. And eventually, a few things start getting recognized. They actually deliver something useful. So virtual reality is probably about there, because it can be useful in engineering. Rolls-Royce are using it as they actually inspect engines and so on. They can actually have a headset on, and or either AR, augmented reality or virtual reality, as they are looking at a component or an engine to find out what they need to be doing. And then eventually, things sort of come up here, and they're color-coded for when they think it might pop out of the woodwork. And blockchain there, 5 to 10 years, perhaps before it really, we have found which ones are going to get through to about there. But it's always worth looking at this to see how your technologies or where they are and how much critical analysis do you need to put. Anything sort of up there, by the time it gets to here, you really got to start thinking very, very carefully. And the problem is, with these sort of things, a lot of senior execs are very keen to you sometimes to be seem to be looking at the newest technology. It might be something really spectacular for the business, because they've got to do things all the time to keep ahead of their competition, to ensure they are creating value, that they're not wasting money on their existing technology when it could be done better if this new technology works. So you start around here, really start thinking very, very carefully about what are we doing, what can this new technology do for us, why can it do it better and cheaper, and probably faster than what we've got already. Those are some of the critical questions. So blockchain is kind of on the peak of inflated expectations. Now, let's just go back now to what is a standard blockchain DLT type transaction. Well, in essence, you've got four items of data. They typically pack more items around it as well, but the fundamental four are the originator and the recipient. Party A, Party B, some digital signature. There'll be a timestamp with it and a binary package of some sort or other. And notice what I say is a binary package. I've not said it's value or anything, it's just a chunk of binary code. It can be literally anything. In Bitcoin, it'll be a Bitcoin value or identity and so on. But in Ethereum, it becomes a program. But, as has been discovered by some researchers at Aachen University in Germany, even on Bitcoin, which is supposedly just moving money around, Bitcoins only, it turns out that you can put any arbitrary binary package inside the Bitcoin transactions, including child pornography, links to child porn, It's known that there are several hundred photos of various sorts in there. It is known that there are links to 150, 200 child porn sites on the, or links on the black web, dark web. There are a whole lot of other pointers of stuff on the dark web, all of which is illegal, of course. Which raises an interesting question for all of the miners, Bitcoin miners, is they've got complete copies of the Bitcoin blockchain, as does Google Analytics. And in most jurisdictions around the world, holding electronic copies or information about child porn is seriously illegal. Now, the problem now is you cannot delete that data out of the blockchain. It's write once, read many. No delete, no amend. So the law enforcement are going to have some very interesting discussions, I suspect, over the next few months. Once you've done that, the whole transaction is then given the SHA-256 hash code. And that's part of what makes it so difficult, because you don't have to change a single byte, or single digit, sorry, the binary digit in the whole of that message, or one megabyte's worth, to change your hash in an highly unpredictable way. And this is what they do to provide the security. Just going back here. You've got your hash version of there. It goes to everybody in the network. They do some sort of validation to make sure that you're not stuck double spending. And then they add them all together, all these transactions together into a block. Typically, let's say about 2,000 in a block, which is then linked to the blockchain. And once that's all done, then you get your money. Part of this is trust and reliability. What we normally do is that's Visa, or that's our bank, or that's the land registry in the UK. We all trust those. Except some people don't like to do that. They want to go to this where everybody else, we all work together to provide this trusted environment with reliability. And because the hash value of that is essentially calculated by adding that hash value, the hash value of this previous block to that, and that hash value is based on the hash value before it and so on, there's a continuous link to the whole path. So all 50,000 or whatever, how many blocks there are, all go back, no, 50 million, sorry, go back to the beginning of time. And so if you change something here, in principle, if you recalculate all of it, it would take you a long time to recalculate everything. So you can't actually change that, because everybody else has got a copy of it, all 100,000 plus. So that's how, in this essence, you can ensure, or you can actually be certain you can rely on everything that's there.
Once it's in the blockchain and authorized in, you know it cannot be changed, and you know that it is safe.
What they do is they take, in terms of each block, 22,000 transactions. Each transaction, TX block, gets its own hash value. Very quick to calculate, especially if you've got an ASIC that does it. And then you bring transaction 1 and 2 together and create a hash of that. This is called the Merkle chain. Up to, you've got all of those 2,000 transactions, and you've got the hash of the hashes of the hashes of the transactions. What you then do at a block level is, so I've now got my hash for my block. I've got the previous hash from the last block that was created, and a timestamp. And then the proof of work now becomes, right, I have something called a nonce, which is a number between 1 and 0 and, I forget how big it is, quite large, that you change until the overall hash of those four items is less than a particular value. And the way it's done is it has two or three or four leading zeros on the hash value of those four things. And that means you've got to actually, essentially, start from zero all the way through until you find the first nonce value, which gives you the hash, which is has three leading zeros at the present time. And that can take you millions upon millions upon millions of iterations to try that. And that's why it's so expensive to run Bitcoin. Bitcoin now costs 7 gigawatts of electricity permanently. The UK typically uses 35 gigawatts of electricity at peak time during the summer. So it's kind of 1/5 of the UK's summer use of electricity just to run Bitcoin. And what happens is you don't have people, when it was originally constituted, thought up, you and I, if we all did have Bitcoin transactions, we'd be the validators, the miners, and we get our rewards for doing this. The reward is the first person to calculate, identify the nonce that is leads to that value, gets the payment for that block. Currently about 12 Bitcoins. So what's happening now is the miners build huge farms so that they can farm out the nonce calculation across hundreds or thousands of GPUs and ASICs. Because once you finding the nonce is very hard work, but once you've got it, you then say to everybody, I found it. Here is a nonce, here is a list of transactions, a block, and it takes you no time at all to verify that that nonce does actually lead to three leading zeros or whatever. And as we get closer to the 21 million bitcoins, the difficulty gets harder, higher. So instead of being three leading zeros, it'll probably become four leading zeros at some stage. That is very, the mining or the validation is very, very hard work. The checking, the proof by everybody else is, yeah, microseconds almost. So we have lots and lots of possible opportunities. The question for all of these is, why is it going to be better than what we have at the moment? Will it be cheaper? Will it be faster? What are the consequences of disintermediation? Some of those are interesting. And one of the more interesting questions is to do with keeping track of your digital ID. If you're, even within Ethereum, if you are using half a dozen of their digital apps, smart contract aside, each one of those has a separate digital identity. You do not have a master digital identity across all of Ethereum. You've got one for every single thing you're doing on Ethereum, plus all the others, but maybe you've got 200 or 300. Where will I store it? Will I store it on there? How will I communicate that to my home PCs there? How will I use it around the world? And in any case, we forget our passwords. We need to phone up someone or do something to get our passwords reset in traditional ways. Can't do that with this. If you lose your ID, it's gone. How many people have these on permanent backup overnight? Why not, guys? Who's got Apple? iPhones, any? Is yours on update, secure, save, update every night? Yeah, backup every night? Go put it on. You know, it makes it so easy, you know, when you get your new one, if it's backed up all the time, you just switch it on, log in, and suddenly, as if by magic, all the apps turn up on it, everything else turns up. Probably Android does the same sort of thing. Yeah, now the other problem is, think about land registry, owning your house. Now many people move house 3 or 4 times in their lifetime. Some don't ever move. So you've got to have that identity kept for 50 to 80 years. We don't know of any software that's been unchanged for 80 years so far, even 50 years, even 40 years. Even the .txt file formatting has changed twice since it was invented. And that's probably the simplest file structure there is in the world. PDFs changed, when was that? About 5-10 years ago, from pure image record to a text overlay type of thing. So if you've got, I mean, fortunately, there's a bit of forward compatibility. So PDFs from 10 years ago, 15 years ago, probably could still be read. Fingers crossed. Then it's, you know Dennis Parks? He's got some documents from the 1990s, or a bit before that, I forget quite when, maybe like the 1980s. Some DOS-type word processor. He's got a copy, digital copy of this paper on a storage medium which would have those drives to read it. And there is, as we have no software that can run on any known PC or processor. I heard a weekend that McLaren have got a little problem with their first road cars they ever put out, which are now worth £6-8 million. They're having to reprogram or recompile, I'm not quite sure which, I'm not trying to find details down yet. They're having to reprogram effectively the electronic control system for those because they can't get them. They've looked at eBay and they can't get any more replacement processor units. They're going to have a new processor unit and upgrade it. You remember the shuttle, space shuttle from America? Invented, created roughly in the late 60s, early 70s. Its computer that controlled it was a 32K byte machine. They never, ever changed that. They didn't dare. Because they knew that if they did, they'd probably have to go through a full, well, they would have had to go through a full recertification. And by changing inputs and processing, you introduce new problems. And they didn't dare do that. That's why for most of the flights since the late 80s, all of the astronauts went up with their own portable laptops. With their gigabytes of RAM and so on. So we have to think very, very carefully about that. So when I die, who is going to be able to, and how will they get my digital identity so they can then sell my house? Because if I lose my identity, my wallet gets stolen, my digital wallet gets stolen or lost, I now no longer have access to proof that I own that house. I can't sell it. Oh dear. All of these sort of things, interesting opportunities that start the critical thinking very, very early on. Find out whether there is any business value. Is it an improvement? What are all of the consequences about identity management, etc., etc., etc.? And as I mentioned, I'm going to come back to network design and latency before I finished. As you can see, if you're spreading all of those servers around the world, what's the minimum latency between here and, say, China? 500-600 milliseconds? Yeah. And the financial services world, the sort of side, have been chasing ever decreasing latency, so it's worthwhile drilling between the two stock exchanges in Chicago and New York to drill a laser straight line between the two centers to save a couple of microseconds on the transmission. And here we're putting 500 milliseconds into the system plus 20 minutes and some. Not sure it's fast enough. Anyway, the world of financial services, Visa is tens of thousands of transactions a second compared with 6 seconds on Bitcoin in an untrusted environment, proof of work. So, potentially, lots of interesting opportunities, but so many questions that need to be sorted out before we actually start going down that route. And the problem with most of the companies, the startup companies, are doing all of this, is they don't have programmers who understand industrial grade. They don't even understand Microsoft level of commercial quality software, which is, if all else fails, press the red stop button. Most of this stuff is being done by serious hacker grade programming. No testing, no test programs, no test schedules, very little about professional quality requirement specification. And until the, particularly here, and there, maybe even there, and here, all of it in fact,
until proper requirement specification approaches are taken, with really rigorous test schedules and testing, this is going to be a catastrophe. The number of things that are going to go wrong, well, I presume that the banks which are involved in all this, once the technology gets developed, they will start putting it through their formal test programs, even if they've got some startup to hack the stuff together, they will put that through very rigorous testing, because they that's what they do. And then a lot of this will suddenly, I think, evaporate. Like what happens with all hype curve stuff. We saw it with the digital economy back in 2000, 2001, the dot-com boom bust. How many proper big companies have survived? Amazon? A bit later on Facebook, a bit later Uber, Airbnb, Uber, Google. Most of the companies in 2000, 2001, on this huge hype, absorbing staggering amounts of money, just vanished into thin air. Contributing to the fact that IT is probably the most value destructive industry in the world. Although we rely totally on it, it makes our life so difficult. A recent paper I read demonstrated that that just the lack of integration between different bits of software we have on that causes a 10% loss of productivity. That is $6, $7, $8 trillion a year wasted activity out of $63 trillion worth of world GDP. No other industry is capable of wasting that much money. And what we have to do is to think much, much more carefully about these new technologies, whether it's AI, big data analytics, blockchain. They all go on this hype, absorb a lot of money, a lot of effort, for absolutely no purpose. And we can do a lot better. And you guys, with your network security background, you can actually start, help ensure if you get employed by some of these, you can actually start asking the right questions, so that the companies start doing the right thing to some extent. It might be difficult. You might be told you do this, this, and this, and you say, yeah, but have you thought about? And they'll probably say no, so maybe you don't even want to go near them. You might actually want to go to traditional businesses rather than these startups, because they don't want critical thinking. On which note, I want you to develop critical thinking. Really, really deep and rigorous critical thinking about everything you do. Some companies will like it, you will be happy there. Other companies won't want it, you won't be happy there. Find out what they want at your interviews and make a choice where you will be happy. Okay, folks, thanks.